What's tea, y'all? I know some of you are out there right now having a hard time, having problems in your relationships, having trouble with life, or maybe you're on social media swiping and swiping, thinking, why can't that be me? Why can't I do that? Well, I'm here to let you know that you can. This is Create Your Own Story with Terrell Garnett, where we not only help you create your own story, but we let you tell yours too. Let's get into it, y'all. What's good, people? So I'm back with another podcast. I know y'all missed me, I know, since last Tuesday. But anyways, I'm here with a special guest, even though all my guests are special. And I'm going to have her introduce herself now.
Hi, y'all. I'm Carissa Villafania. I'm originally from Oxnard, California. I'm currently living in Oakland, California, though. And I run programs for a nonprofit organization. We're a travel organization called Global Glimpse. We provide international travel to students in the Bay Area, New York, Chicago, Denver, Western Massachusetts. And typically, outside of a pandemic, we're traveling and creating these experiential programs where we're traveling to the Dominican Republic, Panama, Ecuador, and finally this year, Costa Rica. Just a little bit about me professionally.
Oh, that's a lot. How did you even get into that?
Well, I think in a lot of ways, like all of my experiences for sure have led me to where I am today, right now, really far from home. But I think especially going to Peace Corps. So right after college, I went directly to Peace Corps. So I went to Sacramento State. I studied ethnic studies and then decided that I had no idea what I wanted to do. And a little bit of me wanted to like run away from home at the time. So I signed up for the most like grassroots thing that I could think of, which is Peace Corps. And if anybody knows what Peace Corps is a volunteer-led service by the U.S. government, and it's a two-year commitment. So I was in the Dominican Republic for eventually 2.5 years right after college. But anyway, while I was in the Dominican Republic, I mentioned before that Global Glimpse travels to the Dominican Republic. So I found out about Global Glimpse while I was there. And I applied and I got hired for the summertime as just like a summer contractor. And then after the summer was over, Global Glimpse offered me a full-time position here in the Bay Area. And I had never been to Oakland before, but I packed my bags and I said yes, and I moved to Oakland. I've been here for 2.5 years now and I love it.
That's cool. And how long have you been doing all this? I've known you for years now, but we lost touch. I mean, I lost touch with all those people. Yeah. We can talk about that on the podcast too, but but anyways, I never foreseen you going down that path. Not that I could think of a path that you were going to go down. I just didn't see that. And I mean, I've had you on social media throughout the years or whatever, and I've seen that you're doing these things and I'm like, oh, that's cool. But I never thought enough to ask, like, oh, how'd you get into this? And how long have you been doing it for? But how long have you been doing it for? Like, how many years has it been?
Yeah, I mean, right after Peace Corps, I did Peace Corps 2.5 years. I've been doing this now 2.5 years more after Peace Corps. So I'm still super green and still like very much in the first stages of my career. But I guess, Terrell, to answer your question, yeah, we were friends 9 years ago. I was remembering today. And you and I were friends when I was in high school. You were probably in high school too, or leaving.
I was not in high school. but thanks for telling my age. No, I'm just kidding. Dallas wasn't in high school. But I was young. I was like in my early 20s, maybe. When I started working at Perry Ellis, that was my first job. So I started there right after high school. I went to college for a little while, then went to the job. So I probably was like when I started there, 18, 19.
Yeah, man, we were hella young.
Yeah.
we were little kids. But yeah, to my point, I mean, it's a different Carissa that you knew then for sure.
Yeah.
And yeah, man, then I went to college and I was ugly. I was like not ugly in the face, obviously I'm beautiful, but but yeah, like it was this yeah, college just like brought out this like this person that probably you knew at the same time when we were working, and when we were working together. And honestly, I think what really brought me to where I am today is just this crazy life experience. I had this like traumatic life experience, I should say, that happened in college that like really turned my life upside down, and that like put everything on its head for me and made me choose Peace Corps. And Peace Corps, if anybody knows what Peace Corps is or what that'll do to somebody's life, that'll change a fucking life, man. I was stationed in the Dominican Republic, but on the border of Haiti. So right smack dab in the border, in the middle of Haiti and the Dominican Republic. And the community that I lived in was incredibly poor. So I went like right back down to like the most grassroots, most organic, like human experience that a lot of people don't get, honestly. And I think that that was like the pivot that like brought me into this venture of where I am now.
And so, you know, it's my podcast, Create Your Own Story. I gotta ask, what happened? Like, you can't just say that and not tell the people what happened.
Let's talk about it. No, yeah, I mean, I went to college and I met a boy.
Always the boys, like, they ruin your life.
Yeah, he was the love of my life. I think so. His name's Taylor. And yeah, we dated for 3 years while we were in college. And then our senior year of college was the year that we were graduating. Yeah, we got in a fight. We got in a big fight. And we weren't talking for almost a month. And I didn't realize how sad he was. I didn't know like what he was going through, and a lot of other people didn't either. And so yeah, one night I was getting a call from his parents at like 2 a.m. and I knew what had happened, it like almost internally. But I got the call that Taylor checked himself into a hotel room and he shot himself in the head.
Oh, wow.
And it was the most traumatic and like gruesome thing that's ever happened in my life. But also like, and I hate to say this, but like also the thing that saved my life, because I can't imagine where I would be without that experience. I would probably still be that just like selfish, ugly person that I was in college. So yeah, just a lot of experiences, but I know that that was the experience that really turned my life into what it is now.
And do you think, because I know when people, I want to share something, but I'm not going to, just because it's somebody else's story.
Yeah.
Like I was affected by it, but I know that they listen. Yeah. So I don't want to put their story on blast. However, I know somebody that tried to do something similar, didn't succeed, thank God. But did you blame yourself, or did you feel like how was that navigating through those emotions?
Yeah, absolutely. For anybody that's ever been through an experience like this, no matter what anybody tells you, you're always going, you blame yourself, of course. And in that time, and still now, like I battle myself. I know that ultimately it wasn't my fault, because we are all humans and we all have the right to make our decisions and we have that will. But yeah, I will forever have a piece in me that was like, you could have stopped this, or like, this is your doing, or whatever it is, you know? So absolutely that. And that's where my heart goes out to so many people that have lived through an experience like this and just have that to live with now for the rest of their lives. And I hope that people take that experience and do with it good, rather than beat themselves up for it for the rest of their own lives.
Yeah, I totally can not relate 100%, but to the feeling of like, what could I have done differently, or what could I have done more of? If I would have just said one thing, like I still granted the person is fine, but I still replay that in my mind, like, dang. So now any interaction that we have, I try to make sure that it ends on a good note, because I never want that person to go back down that path. Just granted, I know it's not my fault, but again, like you said, there's no matter if it isn't your fault, or if it is your fault, or whatever the case it is, you're always still going to have you're going to feel some type of blame, or some type of, you know, something mm-hmm. that like I could have done more, or I should have done more.
Yeah, of course, we're human.
Yeah, well, on that note, I guess I'm gonna play a song so we can lighten the mood up again. So this song that I'm gonna play, y'all, it's Kelly Rowland off of her new EP. It's called Flowers. Again, that song is Flowers by Kelly Rowland. So with that song, it basically talks about giving people their flowers while they're still on this earth. I know a lot of times people pass away and, you know, and then we go to their funerals and give them their flowers then, but sometimes we never really get to the chance to mention to people how much they actually do mean to us. Since that experience that you have, how have you navigated your relationships with people? Has it changed how you handle certain situations?
That's a really good question. I'd say that I was like absolutely traumatized, to be completely honest, for a couple of years. So the entire time I was in Peace Corps and a little bit after, after Taylor, I didn't date for about 3 years. And that was like no dates, no talking to boys. Like, I was just like, I cannot fuck with humans ever. The shit hurts. And so, yeah, I just like was completely out of that. I'm dating now and I have a really healthy dating life. I'm really proud to say, but I think that especially what that experience did for me was, one, allow myself to see humans as myself. And really what I said before is not fucking with humans. Like the last thing that I want to do on this earth is make somebody feel insignificant, make somebody feel like they're unworthy, make somebody feel unloved. Because I think that in that time, Taylor was hurt and reaching out and feeling unloved. And what I did at that time was feed that, because I was angry of the fight that we had had. And somewhere along those lines, him as a human was no longer of importance. Or even if it was, I was so hurt that I wanted to project my hurt too. And so at the end of the day, I didn't really understand, or I didn't know how much his hurt was and how big it was and what his capabilities were. We don't know as humans what anybody's capabilities are. And it was just that time where he was like, okay, yep, I don't want to be here anymore. And therefore did something about it. And I think what that did on this side is just allow me to, one, appreciate and value life to a whole nother level. Kelly Rowland's talking about giving people flowers while they're alive. This is not a coincidence, I think, but today is Taylor's birthday. And wow. I sent him flowers. So he's got flowers at his house right now with his mommy and his daddy. And I send him flowers for about every holiday for his anniversary, for the anniversary, his birthdays and stuff like that, and then the holidays. And here I am going to be sending this man flowers for the rest of my life. But what I should have done was love him when he was here and forgiven him when he was here.
Sorry. Unplug my charger. Thing was messing up. No, I totally think that that's quite a coincidence. Like, that's a mind blowing. Like, you know, there's a reason. I mean, it's good though that you're able to share your story so people can hear it, and people that are maybe even in his situation know that doesn't have to be the end, I guess you would say.
Absolutely, that. And it's been hard, man. I wasn't able to talk about it for a really long time, and maybe that's why I'm talking about it today, because he's like, it's my birthday, you can do it, baby. Happy birthday to an angel.
That's amazing. Well, shifting gears just a little bit, I do have a question, because I find that you're successful, but the question more so is motivation important, and how do you personally motivate yourself?
Yeah, motivation is super important. I be having those days, man, where I'm like prying myself out of bed, days and weeks where I like, I don't want to do a goddamn thing. And yeah, I think I shared with you too that in the last, shit, how long have I been with her now? 7 or 8 months, I have my own life coach. And that's, it's really like gotten me to want to pursue life coaching even more, having a life coach, because I see how beneficial it is. But anyway, a lot of the things that we were working at the very start were like motivation. And sometimes that's motivation for my professional work. Sometimes it's motivation for my personal life. Sometimes it's just motivation for like being alive. But motivation in any sense is incredibly important. And the way that I motivate myself, I don't want to be fucking sad. And that's motivating in itself. But yeah, I think I have this little thing where I tell myself to choose life, and it's like so small and like even almost insignificant, but yeah, and I hate to keep going back to this, but just going right back to Taylor, right? Like, there's a lot of people on this earth that decide not to choose life. And that's a choice, right? And there's a lot of people on this earth that still do not choose life in like a spiritual, emotional way, but they're alive physically and therefore are dead, just like on this earth. Depression, we see it in depression, we see it when people are just like in these states of negativity and in these states of like shit, basically. Yeah. And I guess for me, every day, just like this little reminder to choose life and recognizing and acknowledging that everything is my choice, whether it's my mood, my emotions, my physical abilities, whatever, all of those things are my choice. And I think that that's just like the blanket of all of this is wanting to just be happy or in a happy state.
Yeah, I totally agree. I remember, I feel like a lot of times people like to blame people or use a scapegoat on as to why they're not happy or as to why they're not motivated. I remember somebody told me once, that I make their self-esteem low. I said, it's called self-esteem. How the fuck did I make that low? I get what you're saying, but like, don't get mad at me because I'm constantly keeping you accountable and telling you the truth. So if you don't make some changes in your life, then of course you're going to still stay in this certain place. But I personally can't make you unhappy. There may be some things that I do that may make you, you know, feel some type of way, but it's a choice that you have to, you know, choose every day. I even have like some friends that'll hit me up in the mornings and like talk about whatever they're talking about, whether it be relationship or jobs or whatever. And it's like negative. And I'm like, so you woke up this morning and you chose violence, not happiness, violence. But now I got to deal with it. So some days I'm completely fine. I can listen to it, but other days I'm just like, why the fuck did I answer the phone? It'd be like that though. So with everything that you've gone through, and we're talking about motivation, is willpower, would you say that it's a skill that you've learned, or is it like something that you've improved on over time, or do you think individuals naturally have like a limit?
I think willpower is a fucking habit, man.
What was that? I'm sorry.
I said, I think willpower is a habit. A lot of times it's something that we like have to work at and have to build. Because yeah, just like going back to those days when like I want to do absolutely nothing. And if it were up to me, most of my days or a lot more of my days would look like doing a lot of nothing when I'm sad or in these like bouts of depression or whatever it is. And how to combat that is like being strong-willed of some sort. And a lot of times it comes to like mind over matter. And yeah, I guess that like internal will to choose life is just that. But yeah, it's like something I think that is like constantly worked at too. Just the way that we like build these habits for like working out, eating healthy, waking up at whatever time you wake up at. It's the will to like choose positivity over negativity or whatever it is I think a muscle that we have to build at.
Yeah, I 100% totally agree with you. So over the course of the last, I've seen you last 9 years, like, do you keep in touch with any of those people that we work with, friends with, or whatever?
No, man, not at all. Yeah, since I left Oxnard, I sadly, but naturally, I think, I just didn't keep in touch with a lot. There's probably a handful of people that I will keep in touch with on Instagram every once in a while. My good friends, obviously, that I've just like been riding with for a long time, but everybody else I haven't spoken to.
Yeah, in years. I haven't. I seen Edlene. Like in Target, her and Naomi in Target. Yeah. A couple months back, and Edlene's on her third child. Now she's pregnant right now, or she might have had the baby by now. And I remember she didn't even want kids, and now you're about to have three. Yeah. Naomi has, I think she has one or two, but I haven't seen. The only person that I sometimes converse with is Alfonso.
Oh, God.
But we had a falling out.
All of these names are so like foreign to me until just now.
You're like, oh yeah, I remember him. But we had a falling out because I don't care. I'll say it on the podcast. We're good now, but our friendship is not the same. Like, so he came out of the closet, and I was like completely shocked. And I remember saying this. They're like, "Oh, are you shocked?" And I was like, "Yeah." I was like, "Well, I never thought he was getting pussy." But I never thought he was getting dick. Like, that never crossed my mind. And so I was like happy for him. Like, you know, like this is your coming out stuff or whatever. I went with him to like the gay bar, you know, to do him, like do you. Like, I'm proud, I'm happy for you. And I remember his boyfriend at the time, I had a mutual friend with his boyfriend, actually a couple, because I guess they went to school with him. So it was about to be Alfonso's birthday. I was like, oh, let's plan a surprise birthday party for him. And he's like, I don't know if he's gonna, you know, he doesn't really like surprises. And I'm like, yeah, nobody likes surprises, but like when it's a good surprise at the end of the day, like you're like, oh, okay, it's not a big deal. So we started planning it, and then he ended up telling Alfonso. Well, Alfonso got upset that I was speaking to his boyfriend. I'm like, Alfonso, I'm not gay, one. And even if I was gay, you think that low of me to think that I would do something with your dude? And he was mad for years. And I mean, years. Like, I tried to reach out, it would ignore me. And I remember I was at Sally's getting hair dye one time, and he walks into the store. He sees me and just walks right out. That shit pissed me off. I was like, I did nothing to you but try to throw you a party, and you're this mad. Like, so I hit him up and I was like, this is uncalled for. Like, you should be able to shop in a store without like feeling any type of way, like, you know. Yeah. So we end up squashing the beef. We always say that we're gonna hang out, but we haven't. And this was years ago, so now, and he has a different boyfriend now and everything. But yeah, I don't really talk to any of them. And this sounds bad, but I don't really care to talk to any of them. Not in a bad way, it's just that like I feel like every few years, friends, like, they run their course.
Yeah.
And that's nothing wrong with that. But like, you know, like, I feel like you served your purpose. I don't know what it was, but I mean, you served your purpose in my life, and it's, you know, time to let you go, kind of thing. So that's just personal to me. That's why I really don't talk to any of them, no bad blood or anything. But I feel that happens every couple of years. I switch friends. even like I had a transitioning this past year, like on Thanksgiving, I said, you know what? I'm changing my number.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm too accessible. So if you want to talk to me, you can hit me up on social media and I'll respond if I feel like it. Yeah, I've like gone through so many friends, and I always say, and I was having this conversation with somebody yesterday, and I'm like, at a certain point, if I keep losing these friends, I got to think, what am I doing? And you know, cause like, that's just common sense. Like, I can't always be everybody else. At a certain point, like, you got to see the role that you play in the situation. Granted, I think I'm an amazing friend. I want to say it's never been my fault why I lost these friends. And I think that to be true. And I'm going to stick to that. But I mean, at some point I have to see like, oh, I could have done things differently. So even to go back to what we were saying about like, choosing to be happy, choosing these things, and making sure that we, when we are in these different types of relationships, that we, you know, leave on good notes or leave on anything. So I always tell people, like, if I ever do anything to you that may hurt your feelings or do any, you know, anything type of thing, please let me know, because that's never my intention, one. And two, I don't want to make those same mistakes with the next person that comes up into my life. But they never do. But they never do. So I'm left to think that I'm, you know, not perfect, but near.
See, you haven't changed one goddamn bit.
But I've grown. Like,
you are grown.
I've grown. Grown. I ain't changed, but I've grown. It's funny that you say that. People say, like, I was in the store one day and someone, I was saying something to one of my friends, and somebody that I went to high school with was like, damn, you ain't changed at all. And I'm like, I feel like that's a compliment. Like, cause there's some people that like flip on you, like, wholeheartedly. And I'm like, I'm glad that I'm not that person. Like, what you see is kind of what you get. And I feel like I've always been like that. Like, I used to read people for their rice, like even Crystal. Remember her?
No.
Crystal, I don't, she had a kid. I don't put her business on Front Street. I could like say something that would remind you of her, but I'm not gonna say that on the podcast. I'll tell you offline. But yeah, I used to read her for all her rights and just, you know, be reckless with my mouth. So I have a little more tact now. That's the only thing that's changed.
The filter's responsible.
Exactly. So I'm gonna play another song right now. Toni Braxton, off of her new album. And the song's called Fallen. It's one of my favorite songs right now. Here we go.
You wouldn't just let me walk out the door for no reason. Forgive what it seems like. Maybe we fight too much, cause it's not our season. So I don't know why I keep falling, falling.
Was Toni Braxton Falling off of her latest album called Spell My Name. So with that, she basically dictates and talks about how she knows that they always fight, they argue, but somehow she keeps falling in love. So it's very, it sounds very toxic. But my question in regards to love and stuff, do you think that you need love to be happy? That us as humans need love to be happy?
I think so.
And yeah. To what extent?
I mean, there's that like very essential piece of love, right? Like you need to, I think that like, I don't know what like the five dimensions of like an essential human needs. I don't remember what they are exactly, but one of those is like safety, right? Like feeling safe in your environment and feeling safe as a human being. To be able to flourish essentially and to be able to like just operate on a like positive manner. And I absolutely think that people need love. Love is at the basis of this. If you don't have love, then what is the opposite of that? What do you have then? I think that what's most important is self-love. First, that's where a lot of, I think, issues come in relationships. Codependency and things like that, where one person or both people don't love themselves enough, or don't love themselves to the extent that they need to be able to love and to give love to someone else. But I guess to answer your question, yeah, love a show. We need it. We need it. We need it.
And do you think that you can, do you feel that people, let me rephrase this. Do you think that there's somebody in the world for everybody?
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Why?
Because you got it. Like when you, I'm going to make a point and you're going to be like, oh, I guess, you know, watch. If you don't go like that, then something's wrong with you. So, so I think about it like this though. When you see people that are not able, whether they be like handicapped in some sort of fashion or just not mentally able to actually be in a relationship because of whatever the reason, I feel like that when we say there's somebody for everybody, I feel like that kind of goes out the window, because that would mean that there's somebody for those people and that may not be possible.
But it might be.
There's a will, there's a way.
Yeah. And there are so many people on this earth and their fetishes and they're like people, not to say that that would be a fetish, but
I watch your words.
Like they're just, can you like, you could imagine, right? Like, yeah. I don't know. You like feet, you like feet. Maybe you don't like feet, but there are some people that fucking love feet. Right. Yeah. And just like, there are just some people that like have these outrageous, and like, not also not saying that that's outrageous, but just these like different, forms of love or like wants for love. And who's to say that somebody doesn't want that? I think that on this planet Earth, we could find somebody.
Agree to disagree.
Yeah, for sure.
Do you believe that you could be happily single then?
Yeah, I believe that too. I did that for a few years. And I think that going back to that self-love, what really allowed me to like not want to fuck with anybody else and like really allow me to be happy on this like so foundation, like on a very foundational basis, was that I was trying to love myself so hard after this thing that had happened in my life. And honestly, in the time that I was in the Dominican Republic, that's the most that I loved myself, for sure. That's the most organic love that I gave to myself, I think.
And what does that look like to you? Like, what did that look like to you?
Yeah, it was very spiritual. And that's something that I'm like, I wish that I had more of right now. And I don't know, it's due to a lot of things, I'm sure. But one of the things I think is like this Western lifestyle. Back in the Dominican Republic, I was living very poorly. Got a full face of makeup right now, baby, and you couldn't find makeup in my home then. Like, just the little things that are important to me now had no significance then, right? I was just this like organic person that was worried about other things that were actually important. And that had substance, and not to say that I am not now, but it was just like this, it was like the most organic Carissa then. Whereas now I just like, there's social media, there's work, there's, like wanting to be better and more successful and be faster and more productive. Whereas then it was just living in this like spiritual space where I was constantly every day trying to find a little bit more about myself and growing in doing so. And that was just like really brought me back to my core.
That's amazing. So after finding yourself and loving yourself, are there things that you wouldn't allow in your future relationships that you did allow prior to this?
Oh yeah, I got boundaries. I got boundaries like a motherfucker. yeah, and I'm guilty in like not letting people know what my boundaries are off the bat. So that's something that I need to work on. But yeah, I think that like, and obviously every relationship is a lesson and it's a like space to learn. But there are absolutely things that I do not put up with or things that are like hard no's for me. And all of those things, whether I voice them at the beginning or whether they like when they start happening, it's really important. And I try to do this as often and as much as I can, is like putting a hard stop to it at the first time and not going back. I'm a hard believer, and this is like a fault too, I think. But I'm just a hard believer, no running back. Like if we're going to try this and we're going to do this, I can do this twice, three times too many.
And that's helped you out?
that's helped me out. Awesome.
I know, because I feel like a lot of people don't really know how to love themselves, or they don't know what boundaries are. And I know some people now that are have let so much stuff slide, and I look at the problems and I'm like, that's not that big of a problem, but because you've let certain things slide so many times that it's built up, so it's not that big of a problem, but in your heart, in everything that you feel, it's everything right now. And sometimes there's no going back from that, and that's partly because you didn't put these boundaries up and you didn't stop these things from happening.
Yeah, and it's a little bit like I'm all about forgiving, because I think that that's like an underlying factor to that, and I think that that's where people get confused. And also, we were talking a little bit about codependency before, I touched on it, and I think that like loving yourself really combats that codependency, because motherfuckers out here thinking that like we need to be with someone, and that's not true. And I personally too have been in relationships or in situationships for far too long, like letting things go back. We're running back once, two, three, four times. Just like find myself looping sometimes. And that's why I'm so like hard on those stops now, because once I find myself in a cycle, it's got to stop. And stopping cycles, putting an end to that chain, is one of the hardest things to do. But that's where really choosing yourself and choosing life comes into play.
Perfect. So I'm going to ask you my favorite question I ask everybody. You probably heard it. That's the only thing when I do these podcasts, I'm like, so now when people are on the podcast and they've listened to enough of them, they're going to know this question. So they're going to come prepared. So I'm going to have to switch it up a little bit. But the question is, and I think you probably heard of it, is that if you had 10 minutes with God or whatever you believe, see, she's ready. But if you had 10 minutes with God, what would you ask him? What would be that one question?
Yeah, I cheated and I said, hear that, so I was prepared. No, I'm kidding though. But when I heard this, I was like, man, T is stumping people. Like that's such a hard thing. It's such a hard question. Like, what do you ask the everything, this almighty that knows everything? And I guess like to give you a little bit of backstory of why I'm thinking this. Have you ever heard of ayahuasca? Okay, so I've done ayahuasca 4 times now. And in my
first... You want to tell the people what it is, just in case they don't know?
Yeah. So ayahuasca is a Southern American...
Oh my goodness. Oh, I'm so sorry. Go ahead. We'll call back. Hey.
Hey.
I'm doing a podcast. I'll call you after 5 because I have another one after this one.
Okay,
bye. Sorry. I put this on a thing, but because it's hooked to my computer, I had no, it just came through. Damn, but you're good.
Cool. I was saying ayahuasca is a South American entheogenic brew. Tastes like ass, but it's incredible. It's a psychedelic substance that people use for religious, shamanic, spiritual purposes in many parts of the world. And where I did it specifically was in the Sacred Valley of Peru. I've gone back twice and I've done 4 ceremonies. So I've drank 4 times. And anyway, in one of my first experiences with ayahuasca, I remember being in this state of bliss. And I remember my mind going to a place where I was existing, like my spirit was existing. And I should say also that ayahuasca allows for ego death. If anybody knows about ayahuasca, one of the most pertinent things that ayahuasca does for a human being is ego death. And I think that that's been like one of the most important things in my life after ayahuasca. But Yeah, I was saying I was in this state of just like existing with the entire universe. And it was the first time, like we know that, right? Like your brain, we've learned about this. We've done research on this. We know that somewhere in our brain. But to really understand it, T, and to live it is something so incredible that like cannot be explained. I really think that every human should do ayahuasca before they leave this earth. But I guess my question to God would be from that experience is, what the fuck are we here for? Like, what is this experience? Not what does it mean? Not what is our purpose? Not it, like, what is this experience? What is the human experience? Because so much of what I think about humans and our experience now after that particular experience is that consciousness being aware of ourselves, and none of this shit even matters. That's why when we put so much substance and so much emphasis on social media, on how we look, on what we wear, in on our relationships, on these fights, on what's going good, what's going bad, at the end of the day, and this is what I try to remind myself of so often, is none of this shit even matters. None of this shit even matters. So I would want to know from God.
Perfect. So I have another question that I haven't asked anybody yet. When my brother gave me this question, because he asked me and I was like, oh damn, that's a good one. Like, and I'm like, oh, I gotta have to use that now the podcast, since people already know the God one coming up. But if you can speak to three people, past, present, or future, doesn't matter, who would those three people be? Like, if you guys had a conversation together, and what would the conversation be about?
Firstly, Selena Quintanilla, of course. And my question to her would be, why is she such a bad bitch? No, I'm just kidding. My question to her would be, like, I guess how she really felt at the time, or how she feels about being a young pop star and like an icon to young girls. And I guess how she plans to like be better. The thing with Selena is that she died so young that like she didn't get to pursue her life in I think the ways that she wanted to, but that'd be cool to know. Another one, I would love to talk to, I think I would love to talk to Gandhi. That'd be a crazy experience.
Yeah. What would the conversation be?
Yeah. I think that I would like to know like his pivot experience. I think that every human has a pivotal experience. Yes. You, I'm sure too. Like this experience where this experience that like made you choose whatever it is, your passion, your like the fire, whatever it is. And yeah, he's just like such an icon for peace. And I don't know if he was just born that way, but I would want to know like what was his pivotal moment.
That's awesome. And the third person?
My cousin Joelle passed away a couple years ago, like super abruptly too. He, to this day, I don't even think like anybody really knows, but he was also fighting with his girlfriend at the time. And then got in the car with his best friend and they were driving over on Rice. If you've ever drove by Rice, or on Rice, one of those train stops, he was driving through and the train was coming. And one of the things that he always liked to do, and I hated this, was when the train was coming, he would and the rails would come down. He would try to beat the train, or he would beat the train and go through the rails, like do like a Z, exactly. A zigzag. And he was just so dumb for always doing that. He'd do it in the car with all of us. And on this particular day, he missed it and the train hit them, and my cousin and his best friend died. Just touching on ayahuasca though, again, too, I've gotten to spend time with his spirit under ayahuasca, which is incredible. But I guess the question that I would have for him is, when the fuck we partying next? What we doing? I miss him. That's my baby. I really miss him. He's just like such an incredible spirit of a person, and very much still alive in so many ways, I think. So I just want to know when I'm going to see him next.
I feel trapped, tears overflowing, emotionally.
Song was just the kind of like the epitome of your story, in a sense, mm-hmm. of how like you've had through pain and everything, but now you're kind of flying free. Mm-hmm. But with everything that has gone on just within the last year with the pandemic, with the social, I know you're waiting for this question too, social injustice and the presidency and everything, like how has 2020 helped you evolve, change? Did you get anything of it that you didn't get out of the previous years? Like, how has it helped define who the person that you are or the person that you're becoming?
Yeah. I don't know that I was prepared for this question, actually. Oh, but I'm glad you asked it. I mean, 2020 has been incredibly different in so many ways, and just like such a pertinent year for so many of us, right? Personally, 2020 for me was not half bad. I would say it was terrible to be aware of all of the deaths and obviously people getting sick and being afraid of that sickness kind of engulfing our own circles and our families, and us too have like lost loved ones. But I think what 2020 did for me personally was really allow me to consider the real importance of life, especially in the earlier times of quarantine when we were stuck at home with our units. And I mentioned that I'm currently in Oakland, California. This is so far away from home for me. So I live in a home in Oakland Hills with five other people, with five roommates. And we got quarantined together here in March. And I really built a like little family away from my family with this home and with these people, and really was able to make these connections that like just kept me going. And I feel really lucky that I had people in my unit to really just keep me alive, right? Whether that was like cooking dinners together, hanging out together, playing board games because we were so fucking bored. I got really lucky to be in a space that was safe and full of love and connections. And a lot of people weren't. There was a lot of people that were quarantining alone in their apartments that couldn't see their families, that couldn't see their friends. And yeah, so I think this year also, I didn't lose my job, thank God. And I've been healthy. I haven't caught the virus, and I've been incredibly healthy all year. My immediate family is all healthy and alive. And so I think what this year has done to me, when so many other people are going through tragedy and through pain, has really allowed me to see the blessings in my own life, from the little things to the big things. And I hope that it's something that I never take for granted, is these blessings and understanding that I am just so incredibly blessed on a level that so many other people don't get. And with that, wanting to do something, wanting to be more, wanting to like give blessings as well, because I know that.
It's amazing. So before I let you go, is there anything that you would like to share with people, anything where they can find you, or anything that you want to let them know?
Find me on Instagram. I'm Kiki A Priori. That's KikiAPriori. thank you so much, T. Honestly, this is really, really cool, and it's incredible to see you on your own journey. Especially as I mentioned before, I'm like just dabbling into barely my own journey of becoming a life coach. And I hope that I can be of service to people. I'm like so terrified of this experience. I think that this is like one of the things that has like really scared me the most to do, because I'm like, I don't want to fuck people up, like give them the wrong advice or ask the wrong questions. But at the end of the day, it like all comes back to human choice, right? And exactly. and knowing that I'm going to be here and be present and doing my best to give, not necessarily advice, but just to ask people the right questions to allow them to come to those conclusions on their own. So anyway, I'm going to say it right here. I'm going to be a life coach, and I'm going to be a great life coach.
Yes, you are. Stay tuned. Yes, you are. Well, it was my pleasure having you and just connecting again after, yeah, you said 9 years. And can't you see black don't crack? No, I'm playing.
I see it.
But no, it was really great just to get to speak with you again and to connect. We will talk soon again. And everybody, please, please, please check her out, follow her, and just have a great, beautiful day, and choose happy.
Yeah, choose life.
Yes. And that's all we have for you today. I hope you enjoyed yourself on this episode of Create Your Own Story with Terrell Garnett. We'll catch you next time.